My name is Maximilian Mensing. I'm currently a student at here at Bonn-Rhein-Sieg University and also working at DJI in Cologne. And I'm going to talk about a little bit about optimizing the driving behavior of self-driving cars using genetic algorithms today. Thanks for showing up at this very late time. I didn't actually expect that many people to come on the last day of Frostcon this late hour. And first of all, what am I talking about? Usually when people hear about machine learning, they think about neural networks and deep learning because this is what's in the media all the time. But there's also another thing, another branch of machine learning, which is less known. It's genetic algorithms, which also has a very nice field of applications to optimize parameters in domains which are less known and where people don't have that much domain knowledge and control. For example, if we want to use self-driving cars, as we would, for example, in Torx, the open racing car simulator.
You used the wrong microphone, I guess.
No, it's speaking.
Yeah, because
sorry? Better? No, the notes is in it. Maybe a little further? No, it's not bendable.
Yeah.
Hello. I think this is better now, I hope.
Okay.
Yeah, okay. Torx is a free and open source software used for 3D car racing simulation. And it has a very nice sophisticated physical model for the racing simulation. It takes into account the material the tires are made of, also the aerodynamics of the car which you're driving, and also how the car behaves on different kinds of routes. And it's widely used by conferences, like for example the Gecko conference used it 4 years ago to do the big genetic algorithms challenge, where people had to train their agents for best behavior on a certain set of tracks. And also Google DeepMind is currently working on agents which can control the Torx cars, which will probably come up in one of the next conferences they are participating. Usually when you're writing software for self-driving cars, the software is very complex in development and testing, because the developer has to think of so many corner cases and there are so many parameters, like for example the distance to the car you can, when you're driving at a certain speed, you have to know how far you have to stay away from other cars in the traffic, or how far can you go in curves, and these parameters are very, very hard to test by hand and to develop by hand, so it would be very nice to have an algorithm helping with this. And here, one possible solution might be a genetic algorithm. Here we only need to develop a very, very basic controller, not taking into account many things you would if you would do everything manually. And then this algorithm is used to train and evolve the behavior of the car to find the best possible driving strategy with a given software. So I've been saying this term genetic algorithms a few times now. What are these algorithms actually? A genetic algorithm is an algorithm inspired by nature, by the natural evolution, also we humans emerged from. And it's basically a method for optimizing parameters in a domain where we have maybe limited or no domain knowledge at all, which might be fields from physics or like for car driving. I'm also not that proud with cars, so I don't really know that much. Maybe I know when to brake and I'm a very careful driver, but well. Here, we can use the algorithm to learn better strategy. And the only thing we need is the problem to be solvable and testable in a situation, simulation, sorry. And also, the problem has to be disposable into a set of parameters describing what we are doing. So we can have actually something the algorithm evolves. These parameters will be called genome or individual from now on. And usually the algorithm starts by initializing a set of parameters, several genomes called a population, where all the parameters are in one individual and we have several individuals, and each of those has to go to the simulation and then we see how good it completed the track, or maybe didn't complete and only got a certain amount of meters on the track, and then the algorithm will start evolving and improving those parameter sets, those solutions, and maybe find the best driver yet. So this evaluation part on the top left would be what I was already talking about. When you're putting the parameter set into torques, it will start, the cars will complete the track, and we will get a fitness value back, which tells us how good the car performed in total. Then the first step of the algorithm itself is the selection part on the top right. This is basically like humans going to the disco where we are selecting the parents for the next generation of children to a certain number of parents gets selected, like usually we assign a certain weight to each individual. If it has a better fitness, it might have a better chance of being selected. And if it has, maybe didn't complete the track at all, or maybe was very slow, it has a lower fitness and has a lower chance of getting selected as a parent. But still, all individuals might be selected for the next generation because a very good performing individual, maybe with a high target speed, can learn from the steering behavior of a weaker individual, and in combination of those, it might improve actually. So the combination is done with a crossover on the bottom right. For the crossover, we are taking two of the parents we just selected and create an offspring from those. This is usually done by just taking maybe random genes from one of the parents and combining them with random genes from the other parent, but keeping the order the same, or taking the first half of the genome from one of the parents and the second half from the other parent, and thereby creating a child like it would be with human production of children. And then, as we know, sometimes dark-haired people get a red-haired child, and this is obviously maybe, okay, those parents, maybe someone had a different girlfriend or different boyfriend at some point, or there was a little mutation. And this is also introduced with this mutation process. We are changing a very low number of the genome, of the genes, sorry, and introduce some new information to it by maybe increasing the target speed or the distance to another car on the track. And yeah, so how do we put this together with torques? First of all, our cars have a few little track sensors, which will tell us with it how far the car is on the left or on the right of the track and how it's tilted to the track. It will tell us the current speed, the gear we are currently driving at, the rounds per minute the motor has currently, and we have 19 range finders distributed over the front half of the car. And depending on those range finders, they show us how far the car is with each of the sensors from the track border. And if there's, for example, the third sensor to the right here in the front here, we know, okay, there's a very steep curve to the right, so we still have to start driving right. And yeah, this helps us determining the curvature. So what parameters are we actually learning here? We have a very, very simple agent. It will just try to accelerate to a maximum speed. And because we know if we're driving too fast, we might not be able to brake before a curve or before a wall and just drive into it, or the motor or RPM for gear shifting. Especially driving beginners like me know this a lot. If you don't have enough rounds per minute, the car will just turn off if you're trying to gear shift, and your car will die in front of the traffic light. And also, if you always shift at the optimal position, it's a lot better for efficient and fast acceleration. And then for curves, of course, we know that we need to decelerate a bit before a curve, and then we need to have a maximum speed we can still achieve, which we can still sustain in the curve, and also need to know how strong we are braking before, and we need to determine the steering strength and dependence to the curvature. And also, if the car gets damaged, we might still want to allow it to complete the track, so we might just limit the maximum speed of a car by learning this parameter also. So let's see how well this works in training. This was done with 30 randomly generated individuals, trained for 50 generations. And as we can see, in the very first generation, it took about 195 seconds for the cars to complete the track. And by running through this algorithm over and over again and evolving the parameters, after about 7 to 10 generations, we down to 155 seconds for the track. And after this, the slope of the learning curve slowed down a bit. And after about 50 generations, we were down to 142 seconds of training, which is quite an improvement, but we can see the most of the learning is done in the very first generations. I'll do a live demo, but I think I'll just complete this first. Others have also used generic algorithms already in industry. For example, this was done by NASA. When NASA had to develop an antenna for the ST-5 mission, they had engineers working on this for years and years, and they didn't come up with a viable solution fulfilling all the parameters for the mission, so at some point they just decided to put all the constraints into simulation and use the genetic algorithm to involve this quite counterintuitive antenna design, which was then deployed on the spacecraft. It's still in orbit, and it turned out to work better than anything the engineers did there. Sorry? Yeah. Yeah, maybe it's a prototype, which they did with a paperclip, actually. Yeah. Yeah, that's just, well, they can create a random solution in the beginning. And also, at our team here at university, we're using genetic algorithms to optimize the shapes of velomobiles, which are basically bicycles you can lay down in and have a chassis, so you have less resistance, less drag from the air hitting on you when you're driving. And yeah, this is just a number of shapes generated with evolutionary methods towards certain parameters, like, for example, good pressure through the road and as little drag as possible, depending on the size you have inside. So let's see how well... Let's just go to my VM. Here's a little talk. And let's just see how one of those agents would behave driving. This runs on my machine. But yeah, I love the full screen modus in this simulation. Yeah, we can see it's somewhere around 5,000 RPM. It knows, okay, I can shift here very good. Goes down to about 70 kilometers per hour in a curve, and we can see that these super steep curves, it's quite aggressive, but still working. Also, there's already a little bit of damage here, so it's quite aggressive, but seems to be performing quite well. With only, like, the entire agent is like 30 lines of Python. All the parameters were trained. The parameters for this were trained, and as was trained without the GUI in the simulation, and only using the simulation. What the actual? Ah, okay, I thought it was driving backwards for a second there. Yeah. Yes, you can completely decouple it, run it in headless mode, and then choose as many processors as you want and run hundreds of simulations at the same time. Which is very nice. When you have a population of 100 individuals you're training, you can train all of them at once and don't have to wait for the others to complete.
What about real streets?
Sorry?
Let's say you have a city center downtown or some, let's say, one city center or something, and then you want to train, let's say, 50 cars running in the streets of one or something.
Yeah.
And hitting each other.
You can also include several cars into training. And yeah. It has opponent sensors too, if you want to, well, extend it a little more. And it will find quite sophisticated driving behavior. We've seen this, that if there's a car chasing it, it might just try completely to keep one of the opponent sensors blocked. So it knows, okay, there's one behind me, and it cannot pass me. And the one behind might be trained in a way. It knows, okay, if there's a strong curve, maybe I can try to push it against the wall, and it will get damaged. Okay, yeah. Any more questions? I think we just jumped over to the questionnaire.
So, what's the lag time of a human driver?
This was the Aalborg track. I think the fastest driver on the 2006 World Championship was 1 minute and 5 seconds or something like that. And this car does about 1 minute 20 seconds after like 50 generations of training.
Do you have comparisons to other algorithms?
We achieved about the same speed and lap time with neural networks. We also trained neural network agents for this, which didn't have any software agent at all. It was only neural network having the sensors I just described as input, and then had some gearing, the gear setting, steering, and braking, and acceleration as outputs. And this got, after a lot longer training, to about the same speeds. Yes, yes. Yes. The question was if we have comparison to other machine learning methods for this. Sorry. Can it deal with obstacles in between?
Dynamic?
Yeah, well, it has these opponent sensors. I think an opponent car driving on the track would be an opponent. It's trying to dodge. Yeah.
Pardon me for asking, but it says it's a racing car simulator, but so can we incorporate like cooperative driving there so that if there is one person, other person, and mutually can find a way and go faster, or it's just used for racing? So I want to be the first one to reach.
It's only used for racing. Yeah. Okay. You mean gene? The question is if genetic algorithms can be applied to other parameter optimizations. Yeah, sure. As long as you have some simulation or some efficient way to test it, you can always use genetic algorithm to try to approximate the almost optimal set of parameters in the end.
Do you have some parameters of the genetic algorithm itself, for example, the mutation rate or something?
Yes. The question is if the genetic algorithm has parameters itself. Yes, it does. I skipped over this because I think, like, if there's people in the audience not really knowing about this, it's a little too much to go into detail about the parameters. But, for example, one thing I actually forgot to say, you can always keep the best you elite and copy it to the next generation so you don't lose progress and don't have a population at some point where no one is performing as well as in the population before. And you can have a crossover rate, so only a certain number of the individuals do actually perform crossover. You have mutation rate, how strong the individuals get mutated and how many of them get mutated, and how large parts of the genome get mutated. There's a huge amount of parameters which you can set again.
Did you notice any patterns, for example, high or low mutation
rate? This totally depends on the problem. It's very problem dependent. And when you're using genetic algorithms, you need to develop a feeling for this, what's good and what's bad for your current problem.
But generally, you can say that you need low mutation rates because you want this evolutionary mechanism to work.
Yes.
If you have too high rates,
it's way too disruptive. Yes, this was also tried. The question was if this was also tried in different tracks. Yeah, this was. This agent was mainly trained for asphalt roads, but we can also perform training on several roads at once, and then we can. Yeah.
I wanted to ask if you trained this on this one track. Mm-hmm. But did you put it on another track?
Yeah. I can do this if you want, right now. Yeah, well, this driver works on almost every asphalt track.
Is there a repository where I can download the genetic algorithms and the talk stuff?
Yes, I will put this onto my Froscon profile, my GitHub link.
Okay.
It's on GitHub.
I can just download it and build it?
Yes.
How well does this perform with different components, for example, or are you always driving alone?
The question is, I think, if this also works with opponents or if the training has to be done differently with opponents. If you put opponent into this, this car doesn't use the opponent sensors. So it will completely ignore opponents and it will just crash into them, lose its behavior, and have to try to get back on track again. You would have to enable the opponent sensors and perform training completely differently if you had these enabled. It was tested, but not for this agent. All right. I think that's it.